month, obviously, or this Lenten series, we're talking about the remedy. And what we're talking about is the remedy for relationships. Now, we all know about relationships. If you've ever been in one of those love relationships, you know what it's all about. Remember that first day when you admitted you liked someone, you told them you liked them, and they said they liked you back, and poof, you were in a relationship. Michelle, you remember that? Good, good, she does, good. I do too. And, you know, it was one of those times, there have been many times in my life when I've been in that place where I'm in a relationship and just fresh and starting and thinking, oh, this is awesome. But the other side of that is the kind of downside of many relationships, and that is the breakup, right? There's nothing more exciting than entering into a relationship. There is nothing little more devastating than a breakup of a relationship. And today, the story of the fall of humankind is about the breakup of a relationship, this beautiful relationship with God. Now, we don't really like to talk about it. I have been preaching for 21 plus years, and 15 of those years every Sunday, and I have never used Genesis 3 as my main scripture in any of my sermons until today. But today, because I don't like talking about it any more than you do, right? Who likes to talk about sin? It's not a fun thing. But today, I thought it was important for us to talk about it in terms of relationship, because it is a story in the Bible. It is part of our scriptural heritage, but it is also clearly defines our breakup with God. Every one of us can plug in our names in the garden, and the garden might have been a sanctuary, or a garden might have been a church somewhere, or a garden might have been a campfire at the church camp one time, when you actually built that relationship with Jesus Christ, but there's also that point when we turn away. And today, we need to hear this story as our story. Let's today recognize our breakup with God and understand God's remedy for relationship. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you today in admitting full well that we definitely are not perfect. We are broken. Every one of us. Every one of us is broken in some shape or form. And every one of us has marred or broken that relationship with you. Help us as we felt your sweet spirit in this place, reminding us that you're there for us. Help us to grasp a hold of that hope, of that gift, and help us to be yours as we learn about what the breakup was all about and what the remedy was through Jesus Christ. In Christ we pray. Amen. So God created. We know that. We hear that in Genesis, and there's two creation stories in the book of Genesis. And God created us in relationship with God. And when he created us, he didn't just say we were good. He said we were very good, right? It was very good. That's what Genesis 1:31 says. God saw everything that he made, and indeed, it was very good. Now, we pick up in Genesis 2, and you can almost feel a sense of love or play even in God as God created. I'm reminded of the Art of Faith class, and I think they have a lot of fun playing in there, but at the same time, they're in this spirit of God. I think that's the way God, this creation story, reads in Genesis 2. It's a beautiful thing. In the day that the Lord made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground, but a stream would rise up from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. And then it goes on to say, then the Lord formed man from dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And I just picture God joyfully down on God's hands and knees, gathering just scooping up the dirt and forming this loving human and breathing into it. That's how real it is for me. And that's what I see in this sense of playfulness or joy that God's creative. It's not, oh, I need a man kind of thing. It is God's creativeness and God's love at work in play. And then he goes on to say, and the man became a living being. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. You see, he's got excited. I've got this guy. Now let's do this land thing, and let's build a garden. And you see this growing and in the east. And there he put the man whom he had formed. Out of the ground the Lord made to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was also in the midst of the garden. And so he's playing. And then God did what I contend is the most loving thing of all that day. God gave us choice with these words, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. You see, God gave us choice that day. Without choice, God could have just made another plant or another animal. But love dictated choice for us. If we didn't, it'd be a one-sided relationship. Have you ever said, I love you to someone and got crickets back? Isn't that great? But that's what it would be if God said, I love you, and we did not have the choice to love God back. And so God has done something for us in a big way. We're given choice that so we too could love. The most loving gift of creation is choice. And the most difficult, right? Because that choice gives us options for good or for ill. I love you, God, is our choice. We don't have to love God, but God gave us that choice, and so we're given this opportunity to say, I love you, God. And that relationship has no equal. But I am reminded of what it's like in those new relationships I talked about earlier. You remember what it's like? You get giddy or squishy or giggly. You guys do too, ladies, I promise you. Or your feet feel like they're off the ground. It's like heaven, right? But we broke that relationship. We screwed up a relationship with God. Relationships are based on trust, and that's what our passage today talks about. Genesis 3:6. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took the fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. And guess what? We all followed the same route. As it says in Isaiah 53:6, we, like sheep, have all gone astray. Amen? We broke God's trust, and our relationship with God is broken. And the first thing we did is we made excuses. Isn't that what we do? The very first thing we do is make excuses. God goes to Adam. Adam said, it was her! Goes to Eve, and she said, it was the snake! One of my favorites that I've heard many, many times along the side of the road is, officer, I didn't know how fast I was going. Anybody hear that before, ever maybe come out of your mouth sometime? So here's my point with that one. And whose foot was on the gas pedal? Is the dashboard not big enough to be able to know what speed you're going? Did the cars around you that were going much, much slower than you not kind of give you a hint that something was different? Not give you a clue? As if it all makes a difference, we say, oh, officer, I didn't know how fast I was going. And I think what we fully expect is for the officer to say, oh, well, gosh, I'm sorry, I did not know that. I am so sorry I pulled you over. I thought you knew how fast you were going. And that's what we do in life. We make excuses immediately. UPI news item quotes the Metropolitan Insurance Company receiving some unusual explanations for accidents from its automobile policyholders. Here's a couple of them. A visible car, an invisible car, came out of nowhere, struck my car, and vanished. This was written. This was what they wrote to the company. The other car collided with mine without warning of its intention. As I reached an intersection, a head sprang up, obscuring my vision. The pedestrian had no idea which direction to go, so I ran him over. The telephone pole was approaching fast. I attempted to swerve out of its path when it struck my front end. The guy was all over the road. I had to swerve a number of times before I hit him. And here's mine over speeding. This was on a Georgia highway up here on 95, just south of 95. Officer, I have a group of Germans on this bus, and none of them speak English. Now, you know in Germany, there's the Autobahn, and there is no speed limit, and they expect me to be in Florida for lunch. And I can't tell them that I can't go that fast. And the officer said to me, he said, well, doesn't anybody speak English? I said, well, there's a guide on there, but she doesn't speak much English either. He let me off. When we're guilty, I'm looking over there at Tom, and I'm like, Tom, these were all fun, right? Don't. That's why we have two gray vans. You're never sure which one I'm in. We have excuses. I bet you have 100 over top of mine so far. Of different excuses. That's the very first thing we do. In the car and in the garden of our own lives with God, our immediate response is excuses. But the truth is this. It was us. Amen?
Amen.
We don't want an I will be your God and you will be my people God. Even though that's what we said. God came to us and said, I will be your God and you will be my people. And God has been faithful to that. But what we want is I will be your problem solver when things go wrong. Your provider, your shoulder to cry on. But we really want to be in charge, right? One right, Richard?
Six.
All right, thank you. RDS quoted, Bob Bichong quoted a quote from C.S. Lewis's Mere Christianity that a friend had shared with him. Most of us are not really approaching the subject in order to find out what Christianity says. We're approaching it in the hope of finding support from Christianity for our own views. We want a God to be convenient, not loving. I mean, that's the first thing we want is convenience. Amen? So, what God did, recognizing how fallen we were and how inescapable for this type of way, is He sent His Son. We all went our own way. Isaiah 53:6 that I read before, all we like sheep have gone astray. We've all turned to our own way. What God did was send His Son, Jesus Christ. And the mission of Christ was to repair the relationship. That's why Christ came. That's why Christ lowered Himself to this world in our way. That is what Jesus meant in John. At the cost of His broken body. In the Gospel of John, it is clearly a story of the mission of God to come and die on the cross for you and me. Now, all the other Gospels tell the same story, but it is a mission in John, and it's amazing. And Jesus faced the same temptations. If you go to Matthew 4, you find the wilderness stories in verses 1 through 11. And basically what that story does is the devil tempts Jesus in the wilderness with three things. He tempts him with, I'll meet your needs, I'll save your own life, gain power and authority over others. And those three things we're susceptible to all the time. every day. We will put everybody else aside to meet our own needs. If it's a life or death situation, we're choosing our life. And power, oh, if I could just be in charge. Amen? You know what I'm talking about. We are tempted with the same things, but Jesus, instead of succumbing to those temptations, submitted to the will of God. Jesus was on a mission. A mission to save us, and so chose not to fall for those things that were on the way. And the mission of God to bring us all to the saving grace on the cross. And with that setting, Romans 5, 18 and 19 makes perfect sense. Therefore, just as one man's trespass led to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. For just as by one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. God came in Jesus Christ with this mission to repair our relationship, to be the remedy for our fallenness. And that relationship is always available to us when we choose Christ. Amen? Amen? You got to believe this stuff, or we're wasting our time here, folks. The choice is ours. The gift is also ours if we choose it. It begins with asking for, and this is the toughest part, and accepting forgiveness. So we ask to be forgiven. But here's the problem. I don't think we do a good job of accepting that forgiveness. It tells us in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But if we don't accept the forgiveness, we are still not choosing God. And I think you know what I'm talking about. We ask God to forgive us, but we don't really 100% believe that God's doing that for us. And so what we do is we carry a burden on our shoulders. It may not be the whole burden, but we don't 100% believe. It's too good to be true. It's free. We can't do anything to get it. And so we tend to think we don't deserve it. And you're right, we don't deserve it, but Christ gave it to us. And if we don't choose to be forgiven, this is really tough, I know. But if we don't choose to be forgiven, we are not choosing God. God called us into this place. 1 Timothy 1:15, the saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Christ came to the world to save sinners. That's you and me. And do we choose that? Do we let go of the things that we've done wrong? Or do we hold on to it as if there's an arrogance to being forgiven? There isn't. There's a righteousness when we are forgiven. So accepting Christ is accepting the freedom of forgiveness. Last 3 weeks, we talked about the Pledge of Allegiance. We talked about one nation under God, indivisible. But what comes right after that? Liberty and justice for all. And that's what God has for us. God has given us liberty. God has given us freedom through God's justice, which was to take the unrighteous and make them righteous through Jesus Christ, through that one person. It makes me want to say the Pledge of Allegiance all day long. Because God has given that to us, and all we need to do is accept it. Larry Broding wrote in the Word Sunday blog, "The fall of Adam and Eve is a template for the sins we all commit. Yet in the cycle of temptation-sin lies a glimmer of hope. The possibility that the cycle can be broken, that someone somewhere will see through the illusion, reject the ego boost, and stop the cycle dead in its tracks. We Christians find that person in Jesus Christ and that place in the desert where Satan tested the Lord." I want to tell you something. God wants nothing more than a relationship with us. God doesn't want our praise, even our money or any of that stuff, without a relationship. God wants nothing more than a relationship with us, and He gave His Son to make that happen. Last week, I quoted from James 4, and we were talking about avoiding temptations then, and we said in James 4, 7, submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. But then verse 8 follows that and says this, draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. What do you choose? It's time to really take this gift of choice that God gave us in this weird place in the garden that made us all fall. It's time to choose the right choice. Amen? And the remedy for relationship always is and always will be the grace of God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.